In this video, we will start to define and describe entropy and the second law of thermodynamics. Our second law of thermodynamics states that for any spontaneous process, the combined entropy of the system and its surroundings will always increase. And as we progress from this section on, it will be very important to pay attention to the subscripts that we're using on notations. So for the second law of thermodynamics, it's stating that the entropy total, and that's the word I tend to use. A lot of textbooks use the subscript universe, which to me sounds a little overwhelming because I don't want to think about the entropy of the entire universe. So I prefer to use the word total, but realize that these are interchangeable. That when we're calculating the total entropy, we have to take into account both the entropy of the system and the entropy of the surroundings. And if the sum of both of those is greater than zero, in other words, a positive value, that's what tells us that a process or reaction will be spontaneous. So another side note on subscripts. The subscript of system can also be used as the subscript of reaction. Because we are describing chemical reactions, the reaction we're studying is the system that we're looking at. And we actually just calculated the entropy of the reaction or of the system. This is our setup where we set up our equation as products minus reactants. So we have already done that one. What we need to discuss now is how we calculate the entropy of the surroundings. A common substitute or equivalent for this subscript is water, and that's because most of the reactions we study in Chem 152, sorry about all of that, most of the reactions we study are aqueous. So for example, if we think about the reaction of an acid and a base, like our favorite HCl and NaOH, we of course know that this reaction will happen and produce our salt and water. The key thing to recognize is that the key reaction is taking place between the acid and the base, the HCl and the NaOH. But that reaction can't happen unless these substances are in water. And so the reaction is the HCl plus the NaOH, but water, this aqueous environment, is actually part of our surroundings. When you review the thermodynamics lab for this semester, that will be a very important factor to consider. And so again, for our second law of thermodynamics, to determine if a reaction or a process is going to be spontaneous, we need to look at the total entropy, the combination of the system and the surroundings. Notice in here, we are specifically referring to the non-standard value of entropy. Again, we're going to emphasize this more as we go through the chapter, but just pointing out now that we do not have that standard notation with that not symbol. So in other words, we are not calculating delta S naught. Just to clarify, that superscript zero, when I say naught, we are spelling N-A-U-G-H-T. And so again, if we determine that the total entropy for a system is greater than zero or a positive value, that tells us the reaction is spontaneous. If we calculate a negative value, less than zero, that tells us it's non-spontaneous. In other words, under those conditions, the reaction won't happen. And then a key thing that, again, we'll come back to is recognizing that when our total entropy equals zero, that determines when our system reaches equilibrium. All right, so as we mentioned, we've already calculated the entropy change for the system or reaction. That was our equation to calculate the products minus reactants. So what we need to focus on now is how do we calculate the entropy change for the surroundings? To do that, we're going to refer to this image. So imagine we have our reaction or our system in here. This is in solution. If we have an exothermic reaction, in other words, this reaction is giving off heat to the surroundings. So the surroundings are outside of this flask. As the reaction gives off heat to those surroundings, realize that the temperature of the surroundings is increasing. And as we discussed in our introductory video, as the entropy or as the temperature increases, the entropy increases. To view it from another perspective, we can view the opposite process. Here, again, we have our reaction in the flask. Molecules that are in the surroundings are outside the flask. Technically water too, but that's too complicated to envision. Here, notice that we're showing that heat is going into the reaction or the system, indicating that we here have an endothermic process. Since the heat of the surroundings, the temperature of the surroundings is decreasing, the entropy of the surroundings is also decreasing. And so putting that all together, what it means is we can actually calculate the entropy of the surroundings by looking at, and here I'm going to use a proportional symbol, it's not equal to yet, but we can say the entropy of the surroundings is equal to the opposite sign of the enthalpy of the reaction, right? Again, in this example, we're showing that the enthalpy of our reaction is positive by an endothermic process, and that means that the entropy of our surroundings went down. In our previous example, we had an exothermic process where we did have a negative delta H, and that showed us that we had a positive sign for the entropy of surroundings. The other factor that is needed in order to calculate the entropy of surroundings is temperature. So temperature is a very important factor in determining the spontaneity of reactions. And an analogy that I like to use here is throwing a rock into water. So if the surroundings already have a low temperature, adding heat to that will result in a pretty substantial change in entropy. This would be analogous to standing at a calm lake. You have a giant rock in your hand and you throw that rock into the water. There's not much disturbance in the water, so by adding a lot to it, we see a lot of disturbance in there. Conversely, if the surroundings already have a high temperature, adding a little bit more heat to it isn't going to make a huge difference in the change in entropy. This would be like if you were standing at a cliffside in a hurricane. I don't know why you would do that, but you are, and you throw a tiny pebble into the water. There's already so much disturbance in the water that adding a little bit to it doesn't make a big difference. The moral of the story is that there is an inverse relationship between the entropy of surroundings and temperature. And so to calculate the entropy of surroundings, we have the opposite sign of the enthalpy of our system or our reaction divided by temperature. So putting all of this together, our entropy total is calculated as the combination of the entropy of the system plus the entropy of the surroundings. We calculated the entropy of the system as our entropy of reaction. That means the same thing. And we just established this equation to substitute for the entropy of surroundings. So if I know my entropy and enthalpy, sorry, I might have just said entropy, the negative enthalpy of reaction divided by temperature. If I know my entropy and enthalpy of a reaction, I can plug those in to calculate the total entropy for a given system. For example, let's say we have this value for entropy of reaction, 35.6, this value for the enthalpy of reaction. We want to know delta S total at 298 K. And so again, I'm going to plug into this second equation. We have our entropy of reaction. And before I plug numbers in, I want you to notice units, because this will carry through for the rest of the chapter. Notice that enthalpy is in kilojoules, but entropy is in joules. Technically, it doesn't matter which one you convert, but I prefer to convert my entropy into kilojoules per K. One reason is because the new quantity that we're going to define in our next video uses kilojoules, and I think it's easier. It's easier to work with sig figs working with a smaller number than a larger one. And so to plug my values in, I am going to convert my entropy into kilojoules per Kelvin. Now I'm going to add that to this quantity. Notice that I already have a negative sign in my equation, right? The equation is defined with this negative here. So I have that sign. Now I plug in the value for my enthalpy, which also has a negative sign. One thing to pay attention to throughout this entire chapter are signs. Make sure you're paying attention to positives and negatives. Plugging in my given value for temperature of 298K. When you plug all of that in, we get a value of 0.323, and this is kilojoules per Kelvin. For my sig figs here, I'm not going to go into detail about the multiple steps of division and the addition here. The easiest way is to look at the sig figs in our original given values and report our final answer to the same number of sig figs. So for this setup, I use sig figs in values to determine sig figs in my answer. And now we interpret. We look at our definition. Anytime we have the total entropy greater than zero, this tells us it's spontaneous. Because this is a positive value for our final answer, we know that the reaction that has these conditions of entropy and enthalpy will be a spontaneous reaction.